thank you very much for the invitation. And even if Rafa Nieta is still not here, I think he will know the first few definitions which we have here. So it's not a huge problem. What I will talk about is a joint work in progress with John Ofton. And as you will see during the talk, it's basically taking as many results of someone else we could and putting them together to prove two statements, which are clearly hyperkellers, and they are related to integral logic conjecture, so they are both classical and arithmetic in some sense. So I'm trying to put everything together. So a manifold X is called hyperkeller if it's compact and Keller, but for most of the talk it will actually be projective. Then it's simply connected, and finally up to a constant it has a single to zero form, which is simplex. So the shorthand for this will either be HK or IHS from the more algebraic definition, which is this one. So what's an example of this? Well, the easiest one is if you take the smallest possible dimension, which is 2, you have a simply connected surface with a everywhere non-degenerate 2 form, so a trivializing section for the canonical bundle, so you have a K3 surface. Then you can take this example and make infinitely many more in an easy way. You take a K3, and you let S square brackets n to be the Hilbert scheme of zero dimensional subschemes of S of length n. So the general element in here will just be n distinct points without considering the order. So this has a map to the symmetric product. And this map is actually a blow-up of singularities. And one can prove that this guy is generated by a single symplectic form, where the single symplectic form on the smooth locus you have here is just taking the permutation orbit of the symplectic form on one factor. And then you can lift it to this resolution of singularities. Of course, this thing is simply connected, and it's again compact and Keller. So this is either color and all its deformations are called manifolds. Here I mean smooth deformations.
Also K deformation.
Yes. All smooth scalar deformations. So basically all deformations which will still be hyperscalars. And I will drop the N when this will be clear. Notice that there are more deformations of these manifolds than deformations of K3 surfaces. Because deformations are H1 of the tangent bundle, and then by this symplectic form, this is the same as H1 of the cotangent bundle, and by blowing up something in here, you increase the H1 by 1. Second example. So both examples are due to Bovilla. You do the same trick with an abelian surface, even a complex torus. Then you consider N plus 1 length subschemes. You see that this has a symplectic form, but clearly it is not simply connected. So you kill off this first fundamental group with the Albanese length. This map actually factors through the symmetric product. And this arrow is just taking n plus 1 points on an abelian surface and summing them up. That's where the name sigma comes. So you define Kn of A. Well, this map is actually an isotrivial fibration, so you could take any fiber, but there's a perfect point on the abelian surface, so we will take this. You take the fiber over zero of this stuff. The symplectic form survives on this, but you killed the first fundamental group. So this is IHS. And all its smooths and killer are called manifolds of Kummer and type. And again, N will disappear if it's clear. Why Kummer? Because if you do this with N equal to 1, so here I should put N at least 2. For n equals to 1, this fiber of the summation map is just points which are equal to their opposite. And it's a smooth surface, which is the resolution of the singular Kummer surface. So what's the first theorem? Integral Hodge conjecture
tolls.
For manifolds, for one cycles, on projective manifolds of K3 and Kummer type. So basically, we can represent any Hodge n minus one, well, in cohomology 1-1 class, as a sum of class of effective curves. So this is actually extremely crucial. There are all possible counterexamples, like already on K3s. You take a K3S, which is generated by a single divisor with self-intersection minus 4. Then by Riemann-Roch, you see that no multiple of this can be effective. So this has no effective divisors. So you can try to generalize this to divisors in hyperkeller manifolds or to curve classes, and what we did is curve classes because it's actually far easier.
And a K3 like that exists by searching to.
Oh yes.
But C is not a curve, it's just a class.
Yeah, C is just some class. It's slightly misleading. Yeah.
Maybe while you're erasing, there's this, Markman has a thing about standard conjectures for K3N type. Is there any connection?
Actually, no.
That's a rational thing. That's a rational
thing. Yeah. So first question one could ask is, what about the two other known examples, which are the O'Grady's? Well, for O'Grady 10, I've not got the foggiest idea about it. And for O'Grady 6, I believe it holds, but then most ingredients are missing. So some corollaries of this statement. The first one was actually proven by Voisin in a far different way. So let X be a smooth cubic four-fold. Then the integral Hodge conjecture holds for two cycles on X.
So you can do Gushmul Kaj as well.
All. I mean, there's a corollary coming up, but it's worse than what we wanted. So let me write down the second thing on cubic fourfolds. So let x be as before. And let f of x be the final variety of lines. So this class basically is given by, well, is the class which gives you the right number when you take two divisors in here and you intersect them with this class. It's a class of Hodge type, but then you can ask, is it algebraic or not?
Is that supposed to be Min Chen's obstruction to rationality? It's something else.
Yeah, I mean, it's a consequence of Chen, of a proposition by Chen. Basically, at some point, he says this class, if the integral logic conjecture holds for f of x, this class is algebraic.
See, but he wanted it not to hold, right?
Yeah, but it holds, so. So, last corollary, let x be a fun fourfold of degree ten and index two. So this is a Bushenkai fourfold. Then the integral Hodge conjecture for two cycles almost holds if x is the general, is our general fourfold with a given Hodge structure. So for those who know about Gushel-Mukais, there's a well-defined period map associating to them their middle Hodge structure, but this is far from being injective. So to prove this statement, which I'm not writing, because there's this almost, we actually need to have some generality hypothesis on fibers of the period map.
General, very general.
For the Hodge structure, I think general is enough. For what is about to come, then it's very general. So we want a three-dimensional middle Hodge cycles. The general one is a two-dimensional middle structure, just inherited from the Grassmannian where this four-foot leaves.
It would be kind of you to write what it's a
Grassmannian. What this is, yeah. So, okay, let me take just one case. This is the Grassmannian 2-6, intersected with a quadric, and then how much? No, sorry, 2-5. And then hyperplane. So in H22 of this Grassmannian, you have two classes, which of course you get here by Lefschetz. And this, we are taking very general elements with one extra class. We have an intersection pairing on this middle cohomology. And we want this intersection pairing to be a lattice of discriminant D. And we want D to be divisible by 8. So there are infinitely many divisors corresponding to this condition in the space of all Gushel-Mukai fourfolds. And the statement is that then integral Hodge conjecture holds for two cycles. So here we can actually prove integral Hodge conjecture, because this almost, which gives us problem in the general case, doesn't hold. The point here is that we can use the theorem to prove that the primitive cohomology is represented, well, the integral Hodge conjecture holds over the primitive cohomology of this structure. Then we of course have that it holds from the part inherited by respectively the Grassmannian and P5. And then we have to check what is the extension between these two parts. In this case, there's an extension of a fixed degree, but we have a parametrization of a degree which is prime to this degree, so we can get any cycles actually. And here, the extension between primitive and non-primitive part has index 2, unless we are in this case. So in the general case, we can prove that the integral Hodge conjectures holds for twice of every cycle, which is not really the integral Hodge conjecture. So the final statement is one more theorem. we have again X, a hyperkeller manifold of K3 or Kummer type. And we want it projective. Then the core of effective curves is generated plus by rational curves. Which is slightly stronger than the other statement because here we really have positive coefficients and also rational generators for this race.
Is that known for K3 surfaces?
Yeah, it's basically, I have to attribute it to the right person. Okay, thanks. So how can we prove the theorem I already erased? Well, it's actually related to some form of conjectures on union rule divisors. There's a conjecture by Voisin which is much more general. So we take a divisor with positive Bovillo-Gomor over the square, which basically means that either this divisor or its dual will be big. And he doesn't ask really this, but it's asking more, but it's what is proven actually. Then there is an integer. That the linear system AH contains a union rule divisor. What she wants is actually some divisor where the orbit of points by rational equivalence is at least one dimensional. So being union ruled is definitely not necessary. You can, as an example, think of a degree 2 K3s, and over Q, the ramification curve will have linearly, rationally equivalent points. So this is a constant cycle curve without being rational. But what we will need is this. So this conjecture has been proven in these two cases for now, K3 n-type manifolds and Kummer manifolds, respectively by Char Facenza. And myself Facenza. So I'm not rewriting the conjecture, because what's proven in these two papers is actually slightly stronger. So it's written nowhere in both papers, but if you look carefully at the proof of the curve class which rules a divisor, you actually see that this curve class is primitive. So let me use this result to prove the first theorem, which was the one about integral logic conjecture. So the first step by taking enough generators H11 of XZ can be generated. Cycles with Q strictly bigger than zero. So, what do I mean by this Q? I mean, I can put H2XZ inside H upper 2 X Q as the dual lattice to the integral cohomology. So I can extend this quadratic form also to curves. Then what we want to do once we have generators with positive intersection, we want to take a a deformation where can we prove, we can prove that there is a rational curve deforming to this thing. And then we want to use some deformation theory of rational curves to prove that our initial curve was already effective.
John, not missing some subtlety. So this h low 1 1 is the same as the h 2n-1 2n-1.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, it's probably.
No. That's
okay. So I mean algebra odd curves, basically odd one cycle.
Step two.
Let C in H 1 1 Z be a primitive curve So I want to take some deformation of the pair XC such that this C prime will be a rational curve. And if I take all rational curves with this same class, I have a component of the moduli space of stable maps which covers a divisor.
You are starting by an effect to come?
No.
C? No.
So no, otherwise exactly. I will be
in fact. Yeah.
So I mean, let's see the primitive one side. Sorry. So here, I'm deforming the class. Much better now.
So you must prove that C was effective.
Yes.
Actually.
Yeah, that's step three.
Okay.
Is effective and actually a union of rational curves. C squared is Q of C.
Okay.
Thank you. So step one is just an ordinary linear algebra computation. Let me start with step two. So usually with hyperkeller manifolds, you don't deform pairs manifold and one cycle. You usually do deformation of pairs manifold and divisor, which are much better understood. So let D be a primitive divisor such that AC is equal to D in the following sense. So you take the previous embedding given by lattice duality, and then you can, you know that some multiple of this class will be defined as an integral divisor. So you take this divisor D, then the formation of the pair X comma class of C correspond to the formations of X D. That is because by this duality, this inherits the same object structure of the second cohomology, and so you also have that if you change the Hodge structure on one side, you change it on the other side, and if D is algebraic, also C will be algebraic. So what do we want to take? We want to take a deformation where D generates all classes of divisors. So this will be a very general hypothesis, the square of the, well, of the one cycle was positive, so also the square of this divisor will be positive, and the moduli space of such pairs is actually a nice quasi-projective variety. So we take a very general deformation and here pick on X prime will be the D prime, and H 1 1 of X prime. Well, I started with a primitive curve, so it will stay primitive also here. This will be and the class of C prime, where class of C prime now is D divided by D prime divided by A, the same one. So what do we know in here? By Charlie and Pacenza theorem, we know that there is some multiple of this d' prime, which has a uniruled element in its linear system. And this is uniruled by a primitive curve class, which is either c' prime or minus c'. prime. So this means that either plus or minus c prime is effective. Well, still with the class. And we could take, of course, the opposite one just by changing here with minus a, so we can suppose it is c prime, so now we want to prove that this R deforms back to X. And for this it is crucial that R covers a divisor. So what is the dimension of this family of rational curves? Well, for general deformation theory, so I'll call it curly M, the dimension of M is at least 2N minus 2, where 2N is the dimension of the manifold. But as this curves cover a divisor, this has to be precisely 2n minus 2. Otherwise, you would have that for a general point of the divisor E, there is a family of rational curves which spans a surface or something bigger, which cannot be possible. Well, probably Mumford. So this is actually good news, because of another result of Ram, which tells us that this kind of curves can deform in their Hodge locus. Two things could happen if the dimension is bigger. One is that they cover something bigger than the divisor, and that's of course false. But it could still be possible that they just cover a divisor, but with many, many rational curves to a point. You basically take the maximal rationally connected vibration, and you have some bounds because you have a symplectic form. So what does this tell us? It tells us that we have a deformation of the manifold X prime, where the deformation, well, the parallel transport of this class is of Hodge type, then we still have a rational curve with this class. Well, actually, a family of at least dimension 2n minus 2 of such curves. So this implies that there exist Rx rational curve on X such that class of Rx is the initial C. And this was the last step we needed, because then we have that all classes of positive square can be generated over the integrals but by some effective curves, actually rational, and this implies IHC for K3 and Kummer type. Which kind of rational curves are used in this proof, as they are very much related to the trimester program of 4 years ago. How do parla in Pacenza, tu versione. And the same for the one I did with Pacenza. So they prove first that all moduli spaces of pairs X and some divisor contain a point of the form an actual Hilbert scheme on a K3 surface, a multiple of a class coming from the K3 surface, minus a different multiple of half the exceptional divisor of this blow up to the symmetric product. And second, the dual curve H minus B over D sigma, well, there are some bounds on this D, which will actually mean that this class is an integer curve. Is represented by a linear series on the linear system H on the K3 surface on a nodal curve. Such a curve moves in a 2n minus 2 dimensional family. So once you reach point 3, then you proceed exactly in the same way as what I did before. You use run and you prove that this rational curve deforms back to a rational curve over the manifold X. On your special point, you can prove that this rational curve covers, at least set theoretically, a divisor in this linear system, but it's hard to get your hands on the eventual reduced structure, so you don't know if it covers actually a multiple or if there's a different family of curves with the same class, which is a specialization of the general element of the family. So you cannot say that on X it's actually D which is covered. It could be a multiple, but it doesn't matter. The point is that this curve is primitive. And linear series on K3 surfaces are some of the most classical Brillinator problems. So this explains the Italian part of the talk. And I think I'll stop there.
Okay, are there any questions?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. What? But if you consider an hyperkernel of K3 to the n-type, mm-hmm. with the Ricard group generated by which is zero.
Okay.
If you consider the derivative to the power 2 and minus 1, it's indivisible.
Yeah, that's divisible.
Like so when you can avoid the rational class.
Yeah, but like when n is equal to 2, that class is divisible by 3. So it's like on the APW sextic, the dual curve is a sextic, but the divisor is ruled by conics. So you really need to go to the towards this class.
Other questions? Yes.
Is there general reason to believe this should be true for all hypercalculus? I mean, is there some other philosophy behind that integral algebra conjecture should be true for
Actually, I don't see any reason for it to be true in general. Initially, we wanted to disprove it. But then it was true. So,
yeah, some of it would be more interesting, but
yes, yeah, by far.
And what about the integral conjecture for other degree type, other dimension? Other cycles of other dimension. Is it known to be true or untrue in some case?
Over the integers, I think it's very badly understood. Because already in dimension 4, you know that the H4 is given over rationals by symmetric square of the H2, but computing the torsion of this map over the integers is already difficult. So I don't think there's a more general result than this, unless you go through much more painful computations of torsion.
And because usually, I mean, the only cases I know these classes are used is to prove that something is not rational, but of course this is a radically different question.
This is definitely...
So you wouldn't expect neither to be zero or non-zero, the groups.
Well, actually, there's some philosophy linking this kind of manifolds to Fano manifolds somehow.
Yes.
So you could expect, as in the corollaries I said, to gain something about different cycles on Fano manifolds. But then this seems to go in the wrong direction. Because usually you want to disprove rationality of this Fano, like fourfolds.
Yeah.
And what is missing for Hochreide in dimension 6?
So, basically, you would like to mimic this kind of proofs. The first step requires a computation of the monodromy group, which is seems to be more difficult than expected for the Grady 10 dimensional, and more long than expected for the Grady 6 dimensional. And then here, I mean, once you prove that you have some special element in your moduli space, you still have to construct these curves. And the only curves you can deform are rational ones. So here there was a student of Pacenza working in some cases on the Grady 10, but this step is more involved than in the other cases. And this is okay.
Any other questions? Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.